You can listen to The Professional Left wherever you get your podcasts, on Netroots Radio, or at our website, proleftpod.com, where you can also contribute to this podcast. There's a PayPal button at our website, or you can mail us a letter and or contribution at P.O. Box 9133, Springfield, Illinois, 62791.
This is the podcast for April 9th, 2021. It's not safe for work.
Recorded live from the world headquarters of the Cornfield Resistance, where we strongly urge you to ignore the little checkbox at the bottom of the webpage. It's the Professional Left with Driftglass and Blue Gal. Do you want your wife and children to find out what you do at night? Yeah. What? Where did that voice come from? What? Those are your friends. I swear. I was thinking of a new advertiser. I don't have it all worked out yet, but we're going to call it Threat Box. And it will automatically append some ominous threat to whatever shitty email you're using to solicit stuff from, you know, dry cleaners or, drywallers or landscapers.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll stay automatically checked. And if you open the email, you're pretty much agreeing to their terms, unless you check it off, in which case, you know, we're going to have to rat you out to your family.
Well, and with the fact that Trump, you know, had to refund $212 million or whatever it was, that means that there's another $112 million out there that he didn't have to refund.
Right.
People didn't feel like they either didn't look at their credit card statement or they...
No, or they died.
Died or they don't care or it says Trump 2020 on it and so it's okay.
Yeah. And this is 10% of the money, more than 10% of the money they raised in 2020. And the National Republican Party said, hey, I love this idea. And they're still doing it, as far as I can tell.
They are still doing it.
Yeah.
They are still doing it.
How are you doing this afternoon?
Oh, I'm feeling better. I had my second COVID shot this week. Driftglass was unable to because his immune system is a little teeny bit compromised after being ill for a week.
Thank you for lying for me, Blue Gal.
His doctor said, you wait 7 days before you go out and get another blast of having to fight something.
I'm vaccine hesitant.
No, you're not.
For the first shot, but for the second shot. I figure, you know, if you can't get the job done in one shot, you're really not trying that hard.
Well, apparently people are vaccine hesitant about the second shot because they're hearing stories from people who have a bad experience with the second shot and they don't want to have that.
Well,
you know, my experience with the second shot, first shot was sore arm, nothing. Second shot, I was tired for 12 hours and got a really good night's sleep that night. No nausea, no, you know, fainting, no, nothing like that. I think that reaction is rather common, that you'll feel a little run down, not a lot run down, just a little run down.
Yeah.
Get a good night's sleep. And that was it for me. And so we're going to make sure that Driftglass gets his second shot once he's over the issues that he has and his doctor says it's okay. Go ahead and get that second shot. And then we'll make sure we do it late enough in the day that I don't have to catch you fall into bed.
I go down like cut wood and long way to the floor for me. So
it is. So we're going to make sure he has a straight shot to the bedroom.
Yeah. Well, like every other time this has happened to me, whether I'm ill or they just take me out to the backyard and put me under a tarp for a day or two in what we used to call the shame hut.
Shame hut. Mm-hmm. Well, Driftglass, it's been quite a week. And you know, we have another podcast. If you have not been keeping up with us, we did a full podcast on Tuesday to make up for last week.
Yeah.
So you will notice if you're logging in for the first time to your, wherever you get your podcasts, as we say, there should be one from Tuesday and then there's one from today. And we want to keep up with our count of numbers so that that episode 600 is set for accurate. Memorial Day weekend and we do our letter show.
Yeah.
And we've already gotten some letters. So we're looking forward to reading those on the air. And if you want to write to us at our P.O. Box, P.O. Box 9133, Springfield, Illinois, 62791, we'll be glad to hear from you. You can also send an email to proleftpodcast@gmail.com. What do you want to talk about first today, Driftglass?
Oh, I don't know. You will notice if you are a reader of anything, For example, Max Boot wrote this thing this week about Biden Republicans.
Biden Republicans.
And how, you know, and Max Boot, whose previous job was writing war porn for Wingnuts. Mm-hmm. And for some reason now has a column in the Washington Post forever because he is an apostate. And it's like, no, the GOP is dead. You should leave. It's gone, gone, gone. Has spun off a bunch of responses, which are essentially no, because the Democrats are just as bad or might someday in the future become just as bad. You're seeing sort of this resurgence of third party fantasies.
Yes, you are.
Which are the,
you know, happens when Republican Party shits the bed.
It does. It really does. You and I have been watching this Hemingway documentary off and on.
Mm-hmm. Sure, a lot of people have. Yeah.
And how he liked, was it Cezanne?
Yes, Cezanne kept painting the same thing over and over again.
Yeah, and or Bach, the same, the sort of the repetition, the artistic repetition of the same notes. And if you are a liberal, a thoughtful liberal, and you are sort of doing politics in your mind and in your heart, and like we do on paper, mm-hmm. Every day, it gets really hard to paint the same mountain every day.
Yeah, yeah.
So you have to find a little bit of a different angle or a different look. And that's why the liberal superpower of memory is so vital to our enterprise, because we can actually take, here's what conservatives were saying 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. And here's what they're saying today. Notice how goddamn near identical they are, no matter, and all that history that's happened in between hasn't changed them one bit. These are the good conservatives, the ones who want to be thought of as thoughtful. No, Max Boot did this article, and this other gentleman responded immediately to, you know, why I can't join. I think his name is Chris Vance or something like that. He's he was like a state Republican Party chairman in Washington, I think. Now, of course, he's an independent.
I'm an independent.
But he's, you know, I love Max. He's intellectually, you know, and Tim Miller makes a good case over at the Bulwark, because the only place you can go to find any, you know, conservative opinions that aren't Trump opinions are either the Bulwark or the Washington Post, the New York Times, et cetera.
Right.
And, but I can't join it. I can't do it. I can't become a Democrat, because I'll vote for Joe Biden. But what about all the Democratic socialism that's going on down on the ground? What happens when Joe Biden sort of sells out to the Democratic Socialists? Then what happens? I don't know. Wake me when that happens, yeah, and I'll tell you. But
and isn't that what Stuart Varney already has claimed?
Oh yeah.
No, this is a stealth Bernie Sanders party being run by a kind figurehead. Grandpa mm-hmm. Joe Biden is running the party and being nice to everybody. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, evil Bernie Sanders is pulling the levers of power.
Bernie Sanders, the all-powerful, you know, mastermind of it all.
Bernie Sanders mastermind is running.
We'll just call him
the country.
For the sake of our Falcon and Winter Stone, we'll just call him the power broker.
The power broker.
He's the real big bad that's running everything behind the scenes. And the reason for that, I and this is 15, 16 years of experience talking, and another 20 before that, watching and listening politics before blogging and before I started putting anything on paper, is simple. That the reality of conservative politics can change and grow and morph. And, you know, you can go from the clusterfuck that was the Iraq War to the clusterfuck that was the Tom DeLay interregnum mm-hmm. to the clusterfuck that was the screaming about Obama, that scary Negro who's going to make your kids gay.
To the clusterfuck. You missed the 2008 crash. Which
yeah, no. There's a whole bunch of stuff. There's Hurricane Katrina and there's Terry Schiavo. There's just a whole long string of epic proofs to any normal, sane person that the Republican Party itself is the problem, period. And Donald Trump is the, you know, Sharpie underline exclamation point termination of that sentence.
Won Republican primary after Republican primary.
Yes, he did.
2016. And a whole lot of Republican voters behind him.
Mm-hmm. And in 2006, David Brooks could not bring himself to vote for the Democratic Party because they had taken his very good, close personal friend and fellow Likud Party sleeper cell, Joe Lieberman,
mm-hmm.
had lost in a primary. The Democrats had what we call a primary, and Joe Lieberman, who was at the time a Democrat, had lost. And David Brooks lost his fucking mind.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the two-party system's a failure. Everything, it's terrible. Both sides of the The Tom delays on the right and the Netroots Tom delays on the left are equally bad. We need a third party.
That's where he got Netroots Tom delays, though.
Yeah.
Because the Netroots were responsible.
The Netroots were responsible.
Responsible for primarying Joe Lieberman.
He didn't know who the Netroots were, what they were talking about. All he knew was that he was getting his ass handed to him every day because all the shit he'd said about liberals turned out to be a lie. All the shit he said about Iraq turned out to be a lie. All the shit he said about economics and debt and deficit turned out to be a lie. And the nobility of the GOP and how the GOP were a bunch of reformers who loved America. All he was sitting on a pile of shit that was getting deeper every day. And the one thing that's constant across all of those decades is that however deep the shit gets for the good conservatives, the thoughtful conservatives, the ones in the media, the ones on Meet the Press, they will always invent in their imagination a liberal wing that's as bad or worse than the reality that they have helped create. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then throw their hands in the air and say, well, I can't choose because both sides are terrible. And if you just skip across time, literally pick any year, put a pin in it, you'll find some conservative watching his party do exactly what it always does, which is kill everything it touches and weeping into his beer that there's not a third party he can choose because because they, the one thing they always believe, always consistently, and this you can just say, this must be what it means to be conservative, is that liberals are terrible. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if they have to make shit up that liberals have done that they didn't do or should have done that they didn't do, they will. There's a whole thing that David Brooks, you know, just threw a shit fit about all the stuff that Obama wasn't doing. And Jonathan Chait, who is no friend to the left, had to say, actually, all of the things that you're bitching about are things that he's already proposed. Mm-hmm. So, but
it was being blocked by House Republicans.
Yeah, yeah. But it was all this. These are all things they lie all the time, and these are the good ones. They cannot admit that they're just wrong. Mm-hmm. The Democrats aren't the boogeyman that they've turned them into, because if you know, I forget what it says exactly in the Bible. If Christ has not risen, then our preaching is in vain.
That's it, yeah.
If liberals are not really the devil, then I must be a fucking idiot. And I have a house and another house and a mistress and a boat I have to pay for. And I can't afford
a Democrat in office because of the
taxes.
They might increase my taxes?
No. I can't afford to admit that I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about.
Because then that sweet, sweet paycheck from the New York Times will go away.
Right. And this sort of links up neatly with how the mainstream media treats the left. Because every one of those Republican fuck-ups going back 20 years was ably assisted by the mainstream press. The Iraq War was ably assisted by the mainstream press. The myth of the Tea Party was the mainstream media loved them some fucking Tea Party.
Oh, yeah.
And the fact that
2 years to realize that they were just Republican voters from the Bush era. Yeah.
And in each case, what you have going back again, arbitrarily to 2006, because you can go back to 94, 92, 88, you can go back as far as you want. But every time it turns out liberals were right, which is always, it turns out that not just the conservative media and not just Republicans are wrong, but the mainstream press was wrong and complicit. Mm-hmm. And that's why you can't ever allow liberals near a microphone. Because
I want to talk to you about that. This gets into Ten Grain, because Ten Grain had a really interesting post at his blog today called Open Tabs, which he does from time to time, Open Tabs, just what's on his computer and what he's reading. Mm-hmm. And this one juxtaposed some writing in The Bulwark with something by a liberal writer. Do you remember who it was?
Dan Pfeiffer.
Thank you. Okay.
I knew it was a DP person.
Juxtaposed a column in the Bulwark blog, basically, with something that Dan Pfeiffer had written. Dan Pfeiffer. And the point of both of these, as Ten Grain put it really well, that these two kind of opposite end of the political spectrum places were basically saying the same thing, that while Democrats are getting everything right on policy in terms of building infrastructure, rescuing us from COVID, et cetera, what the Republican Party is doing is building a brand.
Right.
And that the Republican Party is better at branding than the Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. And I left a comment And I hope it wasn't too harsh. I hope the comment didn't come across, because it's hard to communicate in comment.
10 grand. It was just the shot talking. It wasn't my beautiful wife. It was just the just the COVID shot talking.
No, man. But the point being, and this is something that I worry about in terms of our podcast too, which is ignoring the issue of race.
Yeah, well, that's true.
And the future of the Democratic Party does have a brand. It's called Stacey Abrams.
Yes, it does. And yes, it is. Which makes me very, very happy.
It does. But we don't talk about that enough, I don't think, you and I. And I was thinking about the John Lennon sign, you know, war is over if you want it.
Mm-hmm.
The Democratic Party can have a brand if we want it. If we white folks will acknowledge and celebrate and endorse and back up our sisters and brothers in the party who are really running things and who are the future of the party. And I mentioned our daughters who are 17 and 19 now, almost 19. And I will go on Instagram to look at baby pictures of my Sunday school class mates, you know, that's really why I'm on there, is to look at kid pictures. But I'll come across stuff that middle child and youngest child are sharing with their friends. And it's all about racial justice over and over again. What is fair? What is right? And it has to do with, it's not just George Floyd, although this week, of course, it is. It's voting. It's supporting mothers, you know, in a recognizing the racial bias against Black mothers is a big deal. And as we embrace the Democratic Party of Stacey Abrams and the values that our daughters are pushing to the forefront of their social media, war is over. Demographics are going to push us toward those goals.
Right.
And so when I, like I said, I hope I wasn't too harsh in my comment, but I was like, you know, when you're talking about Dan Pfeiffer versus the Bulwark, you're talking about old, white, and male.
Yeah, you are. Absolutely.
And the Bulwark is old white guys sitting on the porch who've already made their millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. Trying to stay relevant. And well, Stacey Abrams is marching right past their front porch.
She is.
To the State House.
Well, let me put it a different way.
I'm not saying I'm not saying there still isn't a fight ahead. I'm not saying that Stacey Abrams doesn't have many obstacles in her way that we have to help fight.
Right.
But you know, one of the things about the For the People Act that I think people aren't aware of is that it's not about voting rights in Washington. In Washington, it's about dark money. And there's so much in that bill that is going to get rid of dark money that they're terrified. They don't know what the future looks like without dark money.
There's that provision in there that starts counting white people as 3/5 a vote.
Tucker Carlson just came out and said that yesterday.
I know. This is where I don't know. I mean, we live in the middle of middle America.
Yeah.
We live in the middle of Trump country, and we are
an hour and a half from the literal Peoria. How does it play in Peoria?
So that's what we know.
Yeah.
And that's, I mean, we know a great, I'm fairly well traveled. You're very well traveled, and we're both highly educated. But my job at this point in my political life is to be a good ally to people who I think stand the best chance of saving a country that I care deeply about. Mm-hmm. For the people I care deeply about. Mm-hmm. And so because I'm a guy and come out of a tech background a million years ago, I look for what are the bugs in the system? Why isn't this system working? And I don't pay any attention. I couldn't care less what they say on the Bulwark because they're older white guys, you know, on the porch. Mm-hmm. I care deeply because I have seen good faith attempts by Democrats crushed over and over and over again, run afoul over and over and over again. by the media just bulldozing over them, by them being slandered into non-existence. Republican Party is not selling a brand. They're selling a lifestyle brand. And the lifestyle brand is government doesn't matter.
Government doesn't work.
Nothing out there other than your opinion about Dr. Seuss and brown people matters. And don't pay any attention to what anyone else is doing with labor or the environment. They're all corrupt. They're all the mainstream media. Ignore everything. They're creating a very efficient postmodern fascist party. And they've succeeded. That's who they are now. And since I can't stop Fox News from being Fox News because there's just too goddamn much money, and I can see the damage that it's doing long term to this country, packing the courts so that I don't care what Stacey Abrams does in the next 5 years. Brett Kavanaugh is going to be there for the next 40 years. And so this is a much longer fight than I'm going to be around for. So what I can do is look at the people who are making our lives, our causes, much more difficult. The people who are inside the perimeter, who say they're our friends, who say they're our allies, who say, you know what, we can work together. And no, and they're not. they're just not. And the excuses and the lies and the frauds and the dissembling, they're the same people. You know, David Brooks has been on the New York Times for 17 years, longer than youngest child has been alive.
Right.
David Brooks has occupied a commanding position in the U.S. media, influencing, you know, has a bunch of replicants out there. I mean, Chuck Todd does his script. David Gregory does his script. There's a whole a media universe, which doesn't affect me personally day to day. But you go to our local paper and they feel obliged to print Ann Coulter because of balance, because of both sides.
Well, and Driftglass, just to give you a very two very immediate this week examples.
Right.
There is an article. It's at Common Dreams. It's read Julie Holler, who's with the Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting group. And she came up with receipt after receipt after receipt of mainstream media, New York Times, several people in the New York Times, actually, headline writers, ABC News, CBS News, NPR, all of them making claims about the Georgia voting rights bill. For instance, a Times headline writer used this lead. The state's new Republican-crafted law is set to restrict voting access in ways that Democrats and voting rights groups say will have an outside impact on Black voters. You know, Democrats have blasted the bill. However, Republicans, and it goes on. Conservative groups hailed the legislation's passage, said CBS News, while liberals voiced their concern. That one, in particular, left race completely out of, and several of these receipts left race completely out of the conversation. Which, again, that is white supremacy. When you can decide not to talk about the impact on Black voters and just say, well, Democrats on the one hand feel this way and Republicans on the other hand, who are basing their entire argument on Trump's lie, they don't say. The other example this week is the Derek Chauvin trial, where I am my number one concern is he going to get off?
Yep.
And, you know, But as you've mentioned many times, you want to ask every white Republican in our community, what would you do
if
Derek Chauvin got off and it was one of your family members who got murdered on camera?
Yeah. What would you do? Would you just shrug it off?
How would you react?
Yeah. Well, how should you react? Yeah. How do you get justice when the justice system tells you you can't have it?
Yeah. And we're not there yet. We, you know, there is no verdict yet, but
nope.
The fact that we have to worry about that tells you everything about the criminal justice system in this country.
Yeah, we saw a lynching in our living room.
Yeah.
And I understand the need for everyone in this country to have a fair trial. And that's the problem. Everyone in this country does not have a fair trial.
That's right.
And we can keep saying that and saying that. And I want to bring up a third thing.
Well, no, the other part of that Derek Chauvin trial is portraying him as the one-off.
Right.
The bad cop.
Bad cop. The one bad cop.
The one bad cop. And, you know, okay, so, you know, just clap your hands together, justice done, hoping that he is, you know, found guilty. But then do we turn around and go, well, the system worked? Because no, George Floyd, he's still dead, first of all. And this is happening every day.
What I wanted to mention draw you back into, because I'm clever that way, is you and I were talking yesterday, sitting out in our living room, just, you know, talking about politics and bullshit. You were playing the devil's advocate. And you were
a little bit.
You were luring me into failing, into changing my mind, which I hate so much. But it was who won the, why are we here? Why do Democrats have a majority? Why do they have this? Why do they have that? And I was throwing you like obvious. Well, I thought the Lincoln Project is responsible for everything. I thought they won the Democratic primary. And you walked me back to, it was the 2018 election. And who won the 2018 election for Democrats? It was all of those women, all those minorities who organized like mad and flipped the house. And what was the single most important organizing principle for most of them? Mm-hmm. It was the Affordable Care Act. It was the ACA. It was, as you've said 100 times, watching your mother cry.
Right. While your Republican congressman celebrated at a beer party.
Right.
In the Rose Garden with Donald Trump.
Right. That changed a generation of
it did.
Of people, of young people. And it changed a generation of women. And I radicalized, I would say, I would hope permanently that, oh, they're trying to kill us.
Yep.
They really, really think we're trash and don't care if we die. And it's not that just that they are trying to take it away from us. They, as you said, they partied afterwards.
Right.
They celebrated.
The abusiveness of going to the bar afterwards. After you smacked us around and stole our health care and made us less safe and less secure, you run over and have a party with Coors Light or Bud Light or whatever, a monster.
And you and I remember the struggle that the ACA was, the 170-something Republican amendments and the town hall meetings and Barack Obama going to Baltimore, spending an hour and a half answering questions by himself on the stage with no notes, and the Republican leadership out there, because that was their Republican retreat, saying, look, I'll answer any question you want. I'll be as open as you like. Paul Ryan, if you have good ideas, tell me what they are. But we have to fix this problem. And Barack Obama starting with the Romney plan. He was just like begging Republicans for some ounce of decency and compromise. I'll give you the Romney plan. I'll take away a public option. I'll buy you off. I'll name it for you. Just please give me something. And they loaded it down with 170-something amendments. Mm-hmm. And then a bunch of them that Democrats wouldn't allow because they were poison pills. And at the end of the day, Chuck Grassley leaned over and said, we're not going to pass it. You're not going to get a single.
Yeah, Obama pushed him. According to Obama's book, he pushed him and said, you're not going to vote for this anyway, are you? And he had to admit, I'm not. You're right. I'm not.
Just month after month after month of stalling and lying and stalling and lying, followed by a block vote because it was more important to take the black guy's legs out from under him than it was passing health care for America. Mm-hmm. Okay? That's what happened. That's the actual history of the Affordable Care Act. Jump forward to this afternoon, your husband listening to the goddamn Bulwark, listening to the Mona Charon show, and hearing Linda Chavez, a prominent Reagan administration official, a big wheel Republican who wants to sound like the nice lady who just wants everyone to get along. But I'm a Republican. You know, I'm a Republican since I was born. How does she remember the ACA? She says, you know, I wish we could get back to regular order where you'd have hearings and committees and markups, but we don't do that anymore because both sides are playing this tit for tat game. And for conservatives, I think the breaking point was the Affordable Care Act, which was just
shoved it down our throats.
Just shoved it through, and it was a completely nonpartisan vote, didn't get a single Republican vote, and that was it. And rather than stopping her as a decent human would in an actual environment where opinions matter and you talk to people and saying, you lying bitch, that's not how it happened. Here's how it happened. Her host said, this whole Hatfields and McCoys and tit for tat and blah, 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 that both sides, both sides, both sides. And what I'm watching, this is what I can do. This is what I bring to the table is I'm watching the resurgence of both-siderism among the centrists. Because now Trump's gone and it's not scary anymore. So now we can lie and lie and lie about what happened. And this is why people who are even pretend they're our friend will automatically lie about the past if they're a Republican. Linda Chavez felt no compunction about saying, the whole shit, this whole back and forth sabotage stuff started with the Affordable Care Act and Barack Obama. And it's like, you just, unless you show me a note from your mommy that says you were in a coma for 10 years, you're lying. And you know you're lying. And everyone on the panel with you knows you're lying. And that's why it is really important that liberals not have a microphone.
Yeah.
Because anyone with receipts would stand up and say, you goddamn well know you're lying. But that's the consistent factor over the last 20 years, which is no matter how bad Republicans behave, it's the Democrats' fault. And no matter what we do on the left, that is going to be the consistent message at the mainstream media level, because you can't very well be putting microphones in the hands of people who say, yeah, the problem with our country is the Republican Party and this goddamn network that's been giving them a platform for 20 years. So I agree with you on the ground, politically, tactically. The problem will be solved by demographics and by crusaders like Stacey Abrams. Every inch of the way, they will be obstructed by people who smile and smile and pretend to be our friends and are definitely not our friends. And it makes me terribly impatient when my friends on the left give people credit and think they're doing good by extending a hand to people who have no intention of cooperating with us.
And whose job it is to lie about
that. To lie and delay and sabotage and play for time and hope something on the right pops so that we can get back to hating liberals for policy reasons rather than Dr. Seuss.
Hey, Driftglass.
Yeah, Blue Gal.
It's going to be Rubio.
I know. It's going to be Rubio.
Let me get back to the liberal superpower of memory, because we had an acknowledgement this week that memory is the liberal superpower, and that as a result, it is the conservatives' job to erase memory.
Yes.
And this goes back to Matt Gaetz and Sean Hannity. Media Matters had a post up yesterday, Thursday, about how Sean Hannity in 2018 campaigned, you know, counter-indicated to Fox News policy of not appearing at campaign events. Sean Hannity does whatever the fuck he wants.
Right.
And Sean Hannity appeared at a campaign event for Ron DeSantis, who was running for his first term as governor of Florida, and who was there with Ron DeSantis, but Matt Gaetz. And Sean Hannity shows up, and everybody's excited to see him, and he talks about how proud he is of this Mickey Mantle kid here, you know, Matt Gaetz, fighting the good fight, and puts his arm around him. I'm so proud to be on the stage with this kid. And the reason that they were pointing that out is that Sean Hannity hasn't mentioned Matt Gaetz in 9 days. And it is a totally, as one person on Ari Melber's show said, you know, it is a totally transactional relationship. You're allowed on the Sean Hannity show to say the things that Sean Hannity wants you to say.
Yes.
And if you're an embarrassment in any way to the cause of Sean Hannity and the Republican Party and Donald Trump, you don't get to be on and you're not mentioned. And Matt Gaetz is dead to Sean Hannity now.
Right, right.
But in the process of covering all of this, someone found text messages between Sean Hannity and Matt Gaetz when Matt Gaetz sent a threatening tweet to Michael Cohen as Michael Cohen was getting ready to testify against Donald Trump in open hearings in front of Congress, where, you know, does your wife know about your girlfriend, Michael?
Right.
You better have that conversation and make sure she's, is she going to be faithful to you while you're in prison, etc. Which is witness tampering.
Yes.
Blatant open witness tampering. Well, apparently Matt Gaetz, as everyone does, Matt Gaetz went to Sean Hannity once he got caught by this tweet, and the reaction was not what he thought it should be. I guess he thought Twitter was private.
Yeah, like Venmo, right?
Just like Venmo.
Yeah.
And he went to Sean Hannity for advice, and the text that came back from Sean Hannity was, the public's memory is short.
Right.
This will blow over.
Right.
Don't worry about it. He said, well, I didn't go on TV today. You know, I'm not on TV today, so I guess that's my time out. One day off of TV is you know, my penance for witness tampering.
Yeah. Not even a full halperin, you know?
No, not even a full halperin. And so he said, the public's memory is short. This will blow over. And I thought, when I heard that, I thought, my gosh, that really is their secret, isn't it?
It is. It is. As I'm sure you remember, because your memory, you're a liberal. You have a good memory. You can remember 2 days ago when we were watching, as I mentioned before, the Hemingway documentary.
Oh, yeah.
And I've seen, I think it was Stacy Keach in a made for TV movie about him, and I've read him. And I, as a writer, I'm really familiar, but there was stuff I learned about Hemingway that I thought was very interesting. Genius monster, basically, comes down to. But his days as a journalist at the Kansas City Star, and how he learned to write there, and the style, I guess, which was a big, wide open, kind of corrupt town. And they had a style book. They had like rules for writing, and it was like, use short sentences, don't use adjectives. And you could just take that piece right off the top of the column and go, oh, that's how he writes now. These are the rules he used to figure out how to write, which is great. But one thing he mentioned about journalism, which my eyebrow went up and I looked at you and just smiled and smiled, is that journalism ruins memory.
Yes.
It destroys memory, because every day is today, and you don't care about what happened 2 weeks or a month ago because you're moving on to the next thing. And he said it really just wrecks your brain for having long-term memories of anything, because you're always doing now, 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 now. And we've crammed our entire political culture into that universe now. And you can hear people just whining that, the insurgency was only 3 months ago, and a half months ago, and everyone's forgotten. Well, no, not everyone has forgotten. The people who wanted to forget have forgotten. And what Harlan Ellison used to call, rather insultingly, the great wad, the people who think Dancing with the Stars is the highest form of political engagement, have forgotten or don't care. Mm-hmm. And the people who actually give a shit about democracy haven't forgotten. But right. And that's the problem. We never forget. We never forget. I can remember what George Bush was up to in 2005, 6, and 7. I can remember what Dick Cheney said about deficits. I can remember what Karl Rove was talking about liberals in 2005. I know what they're doing because they do it in public. And they do it in public because they know that the people who have actual influence don't give a shit. They're right.
People that are actually watching them day to day won't remember what they said yesterday.
No.
And so you have the television network of Benghazi, 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 Fast and Furious, Solyndra, Uranium One, Vince Foster, Christmas card list, tan suit, Seth Rich, baby parts, her emails, Sidney Blumenthal, secret lesbian, tarmac, and Hunter Biden's laptop.
Yep.
And now they're freaking out about COVID passports.
Mm-hmm.
Freaking out about Meghan Markle killing, mm-hmm. breaking the poor old man's heart,
mm-hmm.
and killing Prince Philip.
Not anywhere near exhaustive laundry list,
mm-hmm.
of a short period of time in the conservative brain is both instructive and ultimately irrelevant, because mm-hmm. in each of those cases, there was supposed to be some principle involved behind their outrage. Leaving Americans to die, cackling in the ready room as Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama, obviously with Benghazi, they don't care about Americans. They just let them die. Okay, that's for America. That was a tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
What about the 500,000 Americans that Donald Trump left to die? Well, that's a different matter. There's no, this is why, I'll say it again. We call them reprogrammable meatbags,
mm-hmm.
because
mm-hmm.
they don't believe anything. There's no principle underneath the outrage of Barack Obama or Hunter Biden's tan suit or gray poupon mustard. These are just things that you teach a dog to say. Mm-hmm. You teach a parrot to say. And the next day you teach it to say something else and it does that. But in this case, the parrot gets to vote. And the parrot has money so it can buy merch. And the parrot can talk to its little parrot friends and spread the disease. But tomorrow it'll be another lie. And the next day after that, it'll be a completely different lie. And within 2 or 3 weeks, it'll be a lie that completely inverts the values that were supposed to be underpinning the first lie. And you try to argue with people like that, and you can't, because they have no memory of what they said or what they did or what they believed. And they will swear to you. They always thought deficits were irrelevant. And they will mm-hmm. swear to you they didn't vote for George Bush. And I'm terrified to think they believe that.
Yeah.
That cruel epithet of mine, they really are just meatbags who can be reprogrammed by Fox News at a drop of a hat. And they're willing to go along with it. They're willing to do it. Because the alternative is to admit that liberals were right.
Or to admit that they have some culpability for the current death toll.
To admit whatever death toll
we're talking about.
Well, to admit that they are that stupid. They are that credulous. Tullible. They are that dumb. They are that completely unprincipled.
That's why they don't ask for a refund from Trump.
Yeah. And
right? I mean,
and that's why
being conned is hard to admit, because right. then you are gullible and weak and you can't save face from that.
Well, being conned is hard to admit, but being conned and then voting elevating
for the con artist.
Oh, and over and over and over yeah, and over and over again. Yeah. The only thing they have in their pathetic little lives is hating the left. That's yeah. all they believe in. They don't believe in God. They don't believe in man. They don't believe in humanity. They don't believe in life. They don't believe in health.
They don't believe pedophiles are bad if it's a Republican congressman from
right.
Florida.
They all they know for sure is that whatever sins they've committed, the left is worse. And mm-hmm. that there's some big conspiracy out there that one day they'll be let in on that will explain it all to them, and that they should just take the rest on faith. And the problem is there's 74 million of them. And the other problem is there's no institution in our country, like the CDC, can examine a pandemic disease and say, this is what it is, this is why it's spreading, and this is how you stop it. There is no institution in this country other than this podcast that is in charge of examining the Republican Party as a pandemic disease that has a source and is spread in a certain way and has to be stopped or it'll kill us all. And the institution that should be doing that, the mainstream press, has been completely compromised by them. So mm-hmm. they can't do that. It's like if you were, I don't know, if you were a lighthouse keeper and you refused to shine a light out on the ocean because yeah. you yeah. might offend someone.
Right.
It is maddening that the First Amendment, Fourth Estate institution built into our Constitution to protect us from bad people sees it as their job not to talk about the worst problems we have because it might offend the bad people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I don't know how to fix that other than one podcast at a time, one voter at a time, one protest at a time, and to also, to end our little conversation on a high note, to celebrate when we win, to celebrate when we have 4 million shots in an arm in a day. That's a
yeah,
great
yeah.
thing. And to not be so overwhelmed by the just massive mindless machine that just keeps rolling on and on and on, to stop and notice that Stacey Abrams is still doing great. That
well, she's got a lot of work ahead of her, and we got to help.
Yes, we do.
Because this isn't just happening in Georgia. This is a nationwide problem. And Tucker Carlson, apparently, as I said to you earlier today, either he is just a full-blown Nazi in mm-hmm. his heart.
Yeah.
Or he's got a bet with one of his frat boy friends of how far along can I be a Nazi and Fox will not fire me.
Well, you remember what Sean Hannity allegedly told Keith Olbermann.
Oh, yeah. Would our listeners be surprised to find out that we're friends, right?
And Olbermann
says this is just all a show.
Yeah, this is just television. It's just television. Mm-hmm. I tend to come
and
down.
And Olbermann said, we're not friends, Sean, and you're a menace. Something to that effect.
Well, I tend to come down on the side of, I don't know the man. I am mm-hmm. always kind of bitterly amused by my liberal media friends, people who are much higher up on the food chain who are just weeping over their lost friend. You know, Tucker Carlson, I knew him back when we used to party together in D.C. Mm-hmm. and he was such. No, he was always a hollow, opportunistic man on the
spoiled
make.
Brat.
Yep. And he was fashion. Always looking, yeah. he was always posturing and what he used to be on MSNBC all the time. Ann Coulter used to be on MSNBC all the time. Mm-hmm. These are all mm-hmm. people who were scrambling to get attention and power and money.
And go to Politicon and be.
By yeah, saying whatever necessary.
The game,
in
right?
the 90s, yeah. these were all MSNBC, you know, hosts yeah. or in the 2000s. Right. But I think you get to the point that you if you play a Nazi long enough, you become a Nazi.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And if you play a monster long enough, I don't really care what your motives are. Mm-hmm. I think right. you should be right. tried as a monster, convicted
no,
as a monster.
I'm not making excuses for Tucker Carlson, right. but the extent to which he went full eliminationist and they are importing third world voters to replace me. Mm-hmm. And that's really what's happening. And I know I'm talking about white replacement theory because I'm going to say the word.
Sure.
So this isn't me skirting around the issue. I know that's what I'm saying, but it's true. They are importing third world voters. This is what Tucker Carlson said.
Right.
They are, the liberals, the left, are importing third world voters. I have a right as a human white man American to one man, one vote, and they're stealing that from me. This is what he said.
Yes. Oh, I know.
They're stealing that from me by importing third world voters. Well, this is straight out of Mengele.
Right. Well, and this is the last thing I'll mention about Tucker Carlson, probably until next week, is if you use your liberal superpower of memory, mm-hmm. this has always been the razor's edge that the right, the conservatives, the Republicans have walked. Mm-hmm. I have to pander to the lunatics because mm-hmm. the lunatics are my margin of victory. I cannot win an election without Jerry Falwell and Pat Robertson coming over here and putting their hands on my head and blessing me and telling their racist white supremacist crowd to vote for me. And that was goddamn Reagan who was doing that.
Yeah,
that
and you know what? That's interesting because that extremist, those are the people that do have the memory.
Yeah.
They do have a memory that you did nod to them.
Yes.
16 months out.
Yes.
And so it's not election year. It's not midterms. This is when Tucker Carlson can quote unquote safely bow to the Proud Boys and their philosophy. Mm-hmm. And if he doesn't get fired, which he should, he's sealed the deal with them as of now, because they will not forget that he said that. And he needs to play it safe closer to election time.
Well, and going right up through the decades, it's always been, you know, with Gingrich and Limbaugh and all the rest of them, it's always been pander to the racist, pander to the lunatics, tell them they're right. Don't say it publicly, but, you know, and Vin Weber gave who the credit for 94 and Republicans sweeping to the House? They gave it all to Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah.
Limbaugh listeners put them in the House.
Majority maker, yeah.
And it was always, so the people who tell you now, who have appearances on MSNBC every day, who swear they didn't see this coming, are lying to you.
Yes.
Because everybody saw it coming. What they're really saying is, of course we knew they were there. Of course we knew we were pandering to bigots and imbeciles and lunatics and gun nuts and fascists. Of course we knew that. That you had to be blind or stupid not to see that. But the trick was, don't let them overrun the place.
Right.
Get it right up to the edge and then pull back a little bit, get their votes, and then go on to something else. But, you know, and all this while, as they're turning this pressure cooker up, we on the left are telling them, this is an addiction you are feeding among desperately dangerous people, and they're going to keep demanding higher and higher dosages. Haven't you seen the trend line of what sells to these people? And we were told over and over again we were crackpots and we were alarmists and we didn't know what we were talking about, and ignore the fringe until the fringe took over. And then, oh my God, where did all these Republicans come from?
It was your little red state fundy.
Yeah, from 16 years ago.
The votes and bringing that margin of victory and winning those primaries for you.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, they actually expect you to run a fascist government. And if you're not going to do that,
they're
going to
throw you out.
They're going to elect Donald Trump it for them.
And they did. And suddenly, everyone is, oh my God, how did this happen? And in response to this, you know, another liberal apocalyptic prediction coming painfully true. Mm-hmm. The mainstream media did exactly what they did after the last apocalyptic prediction, which was Iraq, which is, are we going to get a bunch of liberals and put them in charge of the message in the media? Oh, God, no. We're going to get a bunch of recently expatriate Republicans and put them in charge of the message.
Iraq war pimps.
Yeah. Iraq war pimps were given media status after the Iraq war because they wouldn't blame ABC, CBS, NBC.
Right.
After the
ratings during the war were great, and ratings during Trump was great, and that's what mattered to them.
And after Trump went to shit, after Trump was actually elected, the people that the networks put in charge of carrying the, oh my God, Trump is a disaster message, weren't the liberals who warned about it. It was Charlie Sykes, and it was Michael Steele. And it were people who were like willing to chuckle and lie and not mention the fact that the network they were on was complicit in what had just happened.
Yeah.
Whereas a liberal could not be trusted to say those things. So, and here we are. You want to do a news roundup or not?
Yeah, let's do a news roundup.
Okay, baby.
The CDC said the coronavirus variant first identified in the UK is now the dominant strain in the United States. That's scary.
However, a record 4 million people in the US received a coronavirus vaccine on Saturday. That is just a week ago. Over the past 7 days, an average of 3.1 million shots have been administered each day, and about 1 in 4 adults are now fully vaccinated, Andy Slavitt said. Our friend Andy Slavitt. He's the White House's senior advisor for COVID-19 response.
He's not our friend. I just love him.
But well, he is everyone's friend.
He's everyone's friend.
And he went from being and he went from being basically not a blogger, because, you know, we're bloggers, but he went from basically being the outside guy that you could trust on healthcare to being the guy in charge, which is it fills me with hope.
Yes. Biden said that he was open to, quote, good faith negotiations with Republicans on his $2.3 trillion infrastructure proposal, but insisted he would not be open to doing nothing. Inaction is simply not an option.
Yeah, that was the sentence that Obama never added to anything.
Right.
Biden announced executive actions to address what he calls an epidemic of gun violence.
And he particularly did an executive action on ghost guns, which are, you can order gun parts without serial numbers on them and assemble a gun. And that seemed like such an easy thing to fix for so many years.
Uh-huh.
But you have to, as Kamala Harris said yesterday, you got to have the strength and the courage to do it. And Joe Biden has the strength and the courage to do this.
Yeah.
Let's get on it. More COVID news. All adults in the U.S. should be eligible to receive the COVID-19 vaccine by April 19th, almost 2 weeks sooner than Biden's original May 1st deadline. All but two states, Oregon and Hawaii, are already set to meet the new target date. Meanwhile, New Hampshire has lifted the residency requirement for vaccination. Think about that. You don't have to live in New Hampshire to get a shot. And of course, those New England states are very tiny geographically, and people do live on one side and work on the other. So the point is, if you work in New Hampshire and you live in Vermont, you can cross over, you know, after work, you can go and get a shot. But they have literally lifted the residency requirements to get a shot in New Hampshire, which means that it is time to start renegotiating those big pharma contracts so that we can give away our extra vaccines this summer to countries that need them. And what, then we're going to watch the Fox freak out about, why isn't Biden immunizing America first?
Why? Future Fox host Joe Manchin said any voting rights legislation Congress passes must make Trump supporters happy. Now break that sentence down. In effect, Joe Manchin is saying that the people who stormed the Capitol, had an insurgency, killed a cop, and tried to overthrow the government somehow did it out of legitimate grievances about voting, and that Congress has to honor those grievances when they pass the voting rights legislation. P.S. Do not forget that the For the People Act has big money against it because of the campaign finance reforms written into it. For Washington lobbyists, as Blue Gal mentioned, this is not about voting rights. It's about a lot more money than you can imagine, dark money.
That's right. In response, thousands of people now support the Professional Left podcast proposal that Biden should announce that Joe Manchin is now his bipartisanship ambassador, in charge of finding 10 or more good faith Republicans and bringing them to the table.
And we'd like to have this formally called the Put Up or Shut Up Act. So, hey,
2021,
if you can show up at the table with 10 Republicans who are willing to override the filibuster of their traitorous party. Over something as basic as Voting Rights Act, I will name the bill after Joe Manchin. But if you can't, shut up. Just shut up. The nonpartisan Senate parliamentarian ruled that Democrats could use budget reconciliation to advance more of Biden's agenda with a simple majority.
Nearly 200 companies signed a joint statement against proposals that threatened to restrict voting access in dozens of states.
And in response, Moscow Mitch McConnell warned businesses critical of state voting restrictions to, quote, stay out of politics. McConnell called it, quote, quite stupid for corporations to speak out politically on incendiary issues like Georgia's new voting law, but said he still supports them giving him money.
And it was such a funny statement he made that Bernie Sanders laughed.
Oh, God,
that's how
yeah.
funny it was. And your Photoshop. Everyone needs to go to Driftglass's blog, driftglass.blogspot.com, and look at his Photoshop of Mitch McConnell. It's hilarious.
And just ignore that, as we said, that little checkbox at the bottom of the screen. That doesn't mean anything. Just blow right past it.
You'll send your mortgage payment to Driftglass, you're a traitor to the Democratic cause. Oh, brother. As part of the ongoing story of Republicans who hate the private sector, Texas Governor Greg Abbott banned government agencies, private businesses, and organizations that receive state funding from creating vaccine passports, saying COVID-19 vaccinations are voluntary and no one should have to disclose private health information as a condition of engaging in normal activities. And Florida Governor Ron DeSantis issued an executive order last week banning businesses from requiring customers to show proof that they have been vaccinated against COVID-19 in order to get service. But God forbid you should be a gay wedding wanting a rainbow cake, because that's a private business's business to deny you service.
It's none of your business. This week, Marco Rubio successfully groveled his way to that all-important Trump re-election endorsement.
Let's see how that works out for him.
Yeah.
More than 500,000 Americans signed up for health care coverage through the Affordable Care Act marketplace between mid-February and the end of March. And Driftglass was looking through a handful of Obama-era Republican anti-Affordable Care Act ads, several done by Rick Wilson and Dick Morris. Oh, my goodness.
It was that I apparently no, I haven't checked recently, Blue Gal. Does Medicare still exist?
Yes,
because it does. I was told emphatically by no less an authority than Rick Wilson's ad, citing no less an authority than Newsmax, that definitely it would be the end of Medicare as we know it. It would kill seniors. There'd be death panels, citing the Heritage Foundation. And this is what it was like, remember, in the good old days.
Mm-hmm,
you know, back when we debated things openly and Republicans didn't lie and, you know, we could have good faith arguments on both sides. Remember that?
I do.
Mm-hmm.
The Trump campaign was forced to refund nearly 11% of the money it scammed from its supporters in 2020, $122 million.
And we've already referred to it a couple of times, but it is my favorite story of the week, really. The National Republican Congressional Committee is warning donors who opt out of recurring monthly donations that, quote, we will have to tell Trump, you know, personally tell Trump, you're a defector, all capital letters. A tool provided by WinRed, a for-profit Republican donation platform, an extortion firm apparently, pre-checks the box to enroll donors into repeating monthly donations by default. Donors who proactively uncheck the box are threatened with being labeled a defector. If that doesn't work out, rumor has it, a so-you-want-to-be-a-race-traitor box will start popping up automatically. Do you want your family to know that you're a race traitor?
Oh, Lord.
Yeah.
And this idea, too, the difference between Act Blue and WinRed is profit.
Yeah.
WinRed is for profit. So extorting money is in their business model.
Mm-hmm.
Investigators from the Manhattan District Attorney's Office seized financial records from the former daughter-in-law of the Trump Organization's chief financial officer. Her name is Jennifer Weisselberg. And I'm surprised she didn't turn over all that stuff willingly, because she's in such an ugly divorce and kind of hates Donald Trump. But, you know, seize it all. Hey.
It's going to be a very strange summer. Also, facing dozens of criminal charges, Joel Greenberg, Matt Gaetz's party bro and co-conspirator, it looks like he's about to flip on Matt Gaetz like the Jesse White tumbler.
JetBlue has decided it's time to restart donations to a member of the Congress who voted to challenge Joe Biden's victory after insurgents stormed the U.S. Capitol. So we won't be flying JetBlue anytime soon.
And as I read this last bit of numbers, Republican polls, hold in your mind the fact that these are the people that Joe Manchin thinks need to be appeased. So that we can get one or two votes to pass voting rights for people. Their right. legitimate concerns need to be taken into consideration. Mm-hmm. 55% of Republicans believe the January 6th insurrection at the U.S. Capitol was led by left-wing activists trying to make Trump look bad. 51% of Republicans also believe that the riot was, quote, mostly peaceful, law-abiding Americans. And 55% of Republicans believe that Trump's 2020 election loss was the result of illegal voting or election rigging.
But they don't believe that Trump's 2016 election win was the result of election rigging or illegal voting.
And I do understand where Joe Manchin is coming from.
Mm-hmm.
Because he is appeasing tyrants because he lives in a state run by or with an overwhelming majority of people who love tyranny.
Right.
And, right. you know, these are his voters. Some fluke of geography and fluke of fate and his personal standing in the state has made him a Democrat, but his state loves the idea of a fascist, Republican, jackbooted thug running the country. And Joe Manchin is trapped between that reality and the desire to remain in office. And so he has to stand up and say things that at some level he has to know is just insane. And he does. And that's what makes the rest of us so angry. And that's why we put our hopes in Stacey Abrams and people like her, because the goal is make the Senate Manchin proof.
That's it. That's our point.
Yep.
And we have a good calendar in 2022 if we don't blow it.
Mm-hmm. You know who was saying that last
of blowing it, and we're not going to blow it this time.
But you know who's saying that 2 years ago? Junior Dude.
Yeah, he was. Junior Dude, who looks at, you know, he looks at the Electoral College map every day. Mm. He does.
He does. And he was like, no, you know, 2020 could be bad or good, but, you know, I don't know if you looked at these numbers, and I'm like, it's like 6 in the morning and my eyes are blurred. No, I haven't looked at them yet today. But this is looking pretty good for Democrats in 2022.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
Cool, man.
He's on it. He's on it.
Uh-huh.
Each week we post to our Facebook page and website an internet kitty sent in by you, the listeners. But this week's internet kitty is a dog. We have Marco. Marco was sent to us via Twitter, and I had to put Marco up this week because of the wonderful story that was sent in with Marco. Marco's owner writes and says, my 17-year-old Haley, who hates me listening to podcasts, says, send Professional Left a pic of Marco as pet of the week. I didn't even know she paid attention. She wears her earbuds in the car. And I told her, that's for cats. And she said, sometimes they accept dogs. So you have a teen listener there, Professional Left.
Oh, man.
Now, whether Haley is really listening or not, Marco is an adorable small dog who likes to curl up on the couch, sort of like a cat. And Marco eats freshly poured dog food, our fake sponsor. Whether you serve Pet Store Perfection or Dollar Store Dreck, your pets will sit on the kitchen floor and demand that the food they eat is only freshly poured. And thank you, Haley, for letting your parents listen to the podcast. We appreciate it.
Well, and this is what they, you know, executed Socrates for in you know, corrupting the youth. So
I didn't know you were going to go that dark.
Well, you know.
Let's sing the song. Freshly poured, freshly poured. Oh, my Lord, it's freshly poured. And you can visit Marco at our Facebook page or website. You can send your internet kitty, dog, or other pet to us, because Haley is right. We'll take any pet. Mm-hmm. To us at our email address, proleftpodcast@gmail.com, or you can also write to both of us. Feel free to write us. We love hearing from you. Be aware that if you write us at any of our addresses, we reserve the right to read your email or U.S. Postal Service. Go Postal Unions! Letter on the air, unless you say otherwise. Hashtag save the post office. Don't forget our gourmet coffee guideline. If you can afford to buy an espresso-based beverage for yourself, buy one for us. This is not charity. This is our job, and it's a labor of love. Approximately 1% of our listeners support this podcast with a contribution, and you can too. See our website, proleftpod.com, for details. Our PayPal postal address information, it's all there at proleftpod.com. We appreciate the two listeners this week who sent us $14 as their 1% of their stimulus money. That was very kind. We appreciate it very, very much. You're officially in the 1%. Yeah. Please share our show on social media, and thank you so much for doing that. Hey, Driftglass, how are the Internet Kitties doing this week?
Well, look, Al, the Internet Kitties want to be clear that keeping litter boxes clean is definitely infrastructure.
Let's think about living. Let's think about loving. Let's think about the hooping and the hopping and the bopping and the loving, lovey-dovey. Let's forget about the whining and the crying, the shooting and the dying, and the fellow with a switchblade knife. Let's think about living. Let's think about life.
The Professional Left Podcast is recorded under a Creative Commons license. Copyright 2021 DGBG Productions.